And I'm going to do this a little different today, if you don't mind. I want to start with a prayer, and I'm going to ask Max, you can unmute yourself, please. And I'll ask Max to deliver thanks for us for this wonderful day that we have to appreciate what we do all enjoy.
Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for this day and for the opportunity that we have to meet in this new kind of form. Just for the experience as it's been, just to be able to see everybody's faces. It's been good. Lord, we continue to pray for all of our people on the front lines and the health and first responders. Continue to be with them as we try to figure out some kind of way, the government leadership of how to reopen everything. So just give us your grace and peace around the world, because we're all in this together. Thank you again for Rotary and for what we do and for the friendships and relationships that we share. Give us your grace and peace in all we're about. And everybody said, amen.
Amen. And Josh, will you today recite our Pledge of Allegiance for us?
I was muted. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Now, Chris Morrow, would you run our video today?
Yep. 1 second.
Can't imagine you do that.
I'm executive director of Georgia Mountains Hospice, and I've been here for 22 years. I hope with this video that we can show people that hospice is not the end all. It's not completely about death and dying. I hope we educate you a little bit, the staff and the pictures that we show you, about what hospice has to offer. I know when my mother became a hospice patient, all of the knowledge and everything that I had learned over the years totally went out the window. I didn't know what to expect or what I was going to feel. So I hope that we answer some of those questions today with this video.
I am so grateful to be able to die at home.
Did she leave?
To have help. To let me see my mountain.
Chris, our video stopped.
The video stops.
Here's
Pete. Did you already leave?
There it goes.
Did you already leave? I got a form I need you to sign.
The video still stops to you?
I see it. I just don't see an audio with it.
I think it has frozen. It stopped.
Hold on.
No pain.
Hi, I'm Kayla Kinzer. I'm a social worker with Georgia Mountains Hospice. I have been here for almost 6 years now. I am the part that works on emotional and psychological well-being. As hospice enters your home, what happens is you're surrounded by a holistic approach to health care, which means that we want to take care of your body, soul, and spirit. And so in order to do that, hospice has identified several different disciplines to make sure that you're holistically taken care of. So my role on the team is to make sure that emotionally and psychologically, patients and families are taken care of. And that means that we process, obviously, death and dying and the emotional aspects of that, but also any sort of life review or family dynamics that maybe people need to seek closure for, or they just need to process how they're feeling or what they're going through that may be related or not related to death or dying specifically. We want to make sure that we take care of all of those individual needs to make sure that the end of life can be as good as possible. So we're always seeking to ensure lots of quality of life for patients and caregivers. And my role on the team is to help process all of that.
I went and I saw the pulmonologist one day at the VA hospital. And by the time we had gotten home, there was a message on the machine that hospice had called and wanted to come down to take us in as a, you know, as an intake. And I was amazed at the speed with which things started to roll along. And within a day or so, I was entered into the hospice program with people coming down. More people than I needed, more people than I even thought existed, came down and showed up, all to take me into this thing. And another reassuring thing, if I can just continue babbling on, would be the fact that I was told that it doesn't necessarily mean that because I'm in the hospice program that I'm going to die tomorrow. It just necessarily means that they're here to make me comfortable for as long as I can live. Nobody knows how long that will be, but it's reassuring.
When hospice started coming to our home, she says, "Why are all these people coming?" And I said, "Oh, this is hospice. They're just some new friends. And they're coming out and giving me some help." And she says, "Am I dying?" And I says, "Yes, we're both dying. We're dying every day just as fast as we can die." And quite honestly, JoJo, I think it's a race to see which one of us is going to go first.
One of the things that I want you to remember when you're thinking about hospice or you have questions about hospice is, number one, that you have a choice. A physician may give you a name of a hospice, but you can choose which one that you would like to use. And also that Georgia Mountains Hospice is nonprofit. We are a true 501c3 nonprofit agency. We've been here for 24 years, and we've never turned down anyone's service. Regardless of their ability or the lack of their funding, regardless of their ability to pay. So keep things in mind that you have the right to ask questions and choose which hospice you want.
I'm Roland Nelson, and I'm part of Georgia Mountains Hospice. Been here 23 years. I've been with this organization four, and I'm proud to be a part of it. And I'm also wanting to let you know about our veterans program today. And proud to be a part of that. We give a certificate and pin to all of our patients who are veterans, and we work with the North Georgia veterans to allow a member of each branch of service to come and give that to them. I'm glad that I could be a part because we can say to them, we are blessed because of what they have done. And we fly our flag high because of men and women like them. And it's a real honor and a real privilege to be able to say thank you to them. It means a lot as we go to the home. We find out some of them, of course, don't want the fanfare, but every time we just at least in an informal way give them the pin or and the certificate, and with a family member there, it touches their heart and tears come. we're glad that we can give to them because they gave so much to us.
I'm Virgil Farrar. I have been with hospice probably 3 months. I found out about hospice through my doctor, Dr. Emily Tatum, at the VA in Blairsville. And my doctor told me that I was going to have to be a part of hospice. I looked at her and I thought, oh my goodness. My eyeballs were stuck to the bottom of my feet. I just freaked out. Well, what she told me was hospice is really pain management. And pain management, it can be done in several ways. She said, Bertha, what if you walk into the VA like you always do? You're always happy. You're always smiling. And that's a pain management, that's level 3. That means you're in a great mood. But what if you walk in here and you're in a bad mood and you're grouchy? That's pain level 7. Well, what we try to do is help you regulate your pain levels. And that's one of my minor things that hospice has done for me.
The main thing, I guess, I want you to remember is ask questions. You're an advocate for your loved one. This is a very difficult time for both the family members and the patient. So ask questions. Don't be afraid to ask what the hospice will offer you, and know that Georgia Mountains Hospice will be there and will help with any needs that you have. I want this to be a comfortable time, or as comfortable as it can be for you and your family. It doesn't have to be a time that you do alone.
Georgia Mountains Hospice is the only hospice in North Georgia that has pediatric patients, and we take that very seriously. It's quite an honor and a blessing to be able to come into everyone's homes and take care of their little angels. So we have taken on several child pediatric cases since I've been with Georgia Mountains Hospice. And in those particular cases, as you can imagine, it's pretty difficult to watch a family have to grieve the loss of a child before the child has succumbed to their illness. So we really want to make sure that the days are as positive and as bright as they possibly can be, and that the patients and the families feel prepared for what's coming, but we also focus on the living. So we want to make sure that they feel joy every single day and that they don't feel like they're defined by their illness or the fact that they're dying. We want for kids to feel like kids and for families to get to enjoy the time that they have to just have family and a whole family. And so we want to be a collaborative part of their care and not be their entire life. And so with Wishes and Dreams, we try to make sure that each and every child that we have on service gets to have a really fun experience. And they have gone to football games at UGA, and they have gone and had princess parties for a day and become princesses for the day. And we've just tried to do some very special things so that they still get to have a childhood experience and their families get to see them as their child and not as their patient.
At least one moment every day, I hear the echo of your voice, and though it's only in my mind, it stays with me. I have no choice.
I reach for you as you your tender touch, your warm embrace.
And though it's been so many years, I still can see your face.
We're all just prisoners of love.
Days go rushing by
with memories we've locked away.
That may not be much, I regret.
You'll be on earth,
but there
sometimes we cannot say. Maybe the ending came too soon. You are the one I can't bear. And though it's been so bad, I still can see your face. Somehow with you, you are the love I guess. We carry on in yesterday behind us. Sometimes I am at home in peace. I close my eyes and love until I and if I chance to meet a day, a sad crazy grief of faith, whose dream warm we have loved here, and long as every night our love may be running to my ocean heart, like all the years have been erased, every shadow of past, I still can see your face. In every shadow of the...
Okay, that was great. And I'm going to ask Gina Penley to say a few words to us today also. If you will, Gina.
I will. It wasn't great. I'm sorry. I don't know, or now it may have just been my computer, but the words were dragging. So I don't know if it was on yours or not. So I apologize for that. I thought that I would do a video that we had made because y'all get so tired of hearing me talk about hospice, but it wasn't exactly as I'd planned. So sorry about that. The main point of this video was just to let people know that they have choices and that there's different things they can do. I wanted to show you some pictures of our families and our veterans and people that we have served in the past, and what some of them thought with their, in their own words. We have people that are very, very supportive and want to tell you what their experience is. So that was the main thing with the video. Again, I'm sorry that it was kind of lagging in the words. I don't know how much time I've got left. That was
you got all you need, Judy.
I want to give you a little update on Georgia Mountains Hospice. We are continuing to see patients. We have a little limited access in assisted livings, nursing homes. They're not letting our CNAs and everybody come in as they did before. But we are continuing to visit and take care of our patients. I'm a little concerned about the opening of businesses. I think our patients are very compromised. They're very frail. So I hope the caregivers that are going into these homes will recognize that. We're going to continue the stay-in-place order at least till the end of the month, and maybe until May 13th, just to make sure that these patients and families are safe. We have had a couple of patients that we have tested that were negative. So far, we have not had to deal with that with any of our patients. I do want to talk about I know people are having issues and with fundraising and changing events. I know that the chamber changed the auto raffle and different things that have been going on. But I want to talk to you about our golf tournament. That's my big concern right now. Our golf tournament is June the 3rd, which Bent Tree, the course is closed. I don't think now I will have time to plan, even if they open it for a June the 3rd tournament. But Georgia Mountains Hospice depends on that money. That's a big deal to us, and I can't go a year without doing a golf tournament. We need to do that. So what I've done, I love the thing in the beginning that said that Rotary wasn't canceled. It was just different. So that's what I'm going to say is Georgia Mountains Hospice Golf Tournament is not canceled. It's just different. We've set a tentative schedule for July 22nd. We are on the books at the golf course. I want to go ahead and start sending out information. I have two or three people that have obligated to do teams. I do have someone that's going to sponsor our shirts, just like they always have. If something happens and I have to postpone it, your money will still carry over to that event. But I want us to go ahead and I know it's going to be hot, but I want to make plans and have this golf tournament and let this be the first time that we as a community can come together and play golf or be out in public. I think everybody's going to be ready for that. But I just want everybody to know how important it is. This will be our 28th year doing the golf tournament, and I just can't see that we can survive without money or that money. We could survive, I shouldn't say that. But it makes it a lot easier to do the special things or the extra things that we need to do. So I'm going to be sending out information. I'll send out the flyers. I'll send out the sponsorships. But I want everybody to put that on their calendar. July 22nd. I'll need volunteers. I'll need teams. I need people to participate in this tournament just like if we did it in June.
So we can actually say that we want to put a team in, and yes. Then if it turns out that it cancels, you know, we don't care. We'll just collect the money and we'll pay Georgia Mountain Hospice.
Right. That's my thinking.
But, okay, that's what we can do.
Yeah. So I hope everybody that's interested in doing a team or playing will send me a message. You can send me one here through this today. Or you, most of you have got my email, just send me a message and I'll hold the teams. Like I say, I've got four teams right now and my shirt sponsor. So I've got a good start.
Well, if you didn't count me as a team, you now have five.
Okay, good. That's what I'm going to do.
Gina,
did I leave this meeting? Did I see that?
I'm sorry, who is this?
Don Martin.
Don, is Don still on? I needed to recognize him for being with us. Regina, is Don still here? You have to unmute, Regina.
Steve, can I mention something to Gina?
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Gina, I just wanted to let you know that I've had to cancel two golf tournaments, April and May, and some of my teams paid. Some of my sponsors on the Shamrock Stroll had paid, and they were very generous when I've called them or emailed them and let them know what we've done and to go ahead and donate. So that's a plus because our students definitely needed the funds that we're going to lose this year. So I think we'll find that also.
Right. I hope so.
Thank you, Dale. And Regina, is Don still on? Do you know?
I don't think so. He had to leave to go do a real estate thing.
Okay.
I'm going to put him down for a team too, so you can tell him.
Okay, we'll do.
Okay.
So our next week program is going to be Sue Appleton with First Readers. Look forward to hearing from her and what she is doing going forward. Also, before I forget, I want to thank Josh for this. It's wonderful, the job that he does to facilitate this for us. And does anyone else have any announcements that need to go out to the community as a whole or our community of Rotarians?
Mr. President, I just, last week, the sheriff and Chris, there's about 18 folks that they've put on some kind of committee trying to give feedback as far as how the community responds. And the two things that we sort of talked about, one was, how do we get the community mask, and what do we do about testing? So that group will meet tomorrow. John Weaver has been sort of coordinating all that, but it's just a way of trying to, you know, ask questions and try to get down to the common denominator of the average person. How do they get these things to be out in public? And one thing about today, during my 39 years in ministry, there's been no finer organization or service done than through the hospice of what they do for people and how they do it. And we're fortunate to have Gina, because we know that Georgia Mountain Hospice is a reflection of her care, a reflection of her love for people. And so we do have a choice. There are different groups out there. And so I'm a little bit prejudiced because I know Gina and I know those folks. They just do a wonderful job. And so thank you, Gina. It is about choices. It is about comfort. It is about respect. So thank you for what you do.
Oh, you're welcome.
We greatly appreciate that. Go ahead. Go ahead.
John had just asked that I repeat the date. Someone did July 22nd, and it's at Bent Tree.
Also, I think that we'd be remiss today if we did not recognize Regina Martin, who hit the front page of the paper, but I think that she has an article in the Smoke Signals this week also. So did a really good job getting the mass out to a lot of people, and is now doing a national effort of some kind. But again, thank you, Regina, for all that you have done for Rotary.
Yay.
Steve, if I
may. So does anyone else have any announcements?
Steve, if I may. I certainly don't want to take anything away from Gina. The work that she does is fantastic. I had the experience of working with her team when my grandmother passed away, or before my grandmother passed away, and the nurses were nothing short of angels. And Roland, my grandmother was an old Southern Baptist, country Southern Baptist woman, and they told me a chaplain was coming to see her, and I was like, I don't know how that's going to go. So I swung by to drop in on them one day, and I walked in, and they were both laughing and cutting up. They had a big time. So, but all that being said, I certainly don't want to take away from Gina, but Windstream was able to come up with a quick little fundraiser, and I want to announce that really quick. We're going to try to help benefit the Boys and Girls Club and CARES. So we've got some T-shirts that we've had designed, and those are going to get blasted out starting probably next week. I'm going to share them with you. So if anybody wants one of those, we're still working out the logistics of how we do that. But the Boys and Girls Club's motto is whatever it takes, and CARES is together we rise. So it may take whatever it takes, together we rise.
Yeah. Good job, buddy.
So those will be coming out probably in the next week. We'd love to sell you one, and hopefully we can double or even triple Windstream's investment and benefit both of these organizations. So thank you very much.
How much are they going to be, Josh? How much are they going to be?
I think we're going to shoot for about $20.
All right. Can we send you an order ahead of time?
You certainly can.
Yeah, we'll do that.
Yeah, we're going to funnel all the money through the chamber, and then Amberly's been kind enough to do that, and she's going to issue a check when it's all said and done and split it 50-50 between CARES and the Boys and Girls Club. So,
very nice.
Oh, that's Josh. Perfect. Great initiative, Josh. Thank you.
Thank you.
Josh, it's Judy. Would you please send me something to put in next week's bulletin about this?
I certainly will.
Thank you.
And while we have Josh on the line here, I want to also say one other thing, and that is that that we need to figure out how to help Josh with his First Foundation. Now, we've got First Foundation next week, which is appropriate, but some way we need to figure out how to funnel enough money to Josh to get him out of jail, you know, because I understand that's where he's going to be. So, Josh, any recommendations how we go about doing this?
So I'm not sure about that, but full disclosure, I've been quarantined at home with my wife, and she's kind of hoping I don't raise the bell so they'll come get me. I'm just going to put that out there.
Oh, God, no.
Well, it's another year and a half before he's president, so he can just stay in jail. We don't, you know, other than giving the meetings, we're okay, Josh.
That might be a little long.
Steve, do you have any sense of when we're going to be able to meet again in person?
I have a great desire to meet again in person, but officially I think that right at this particular moment, we're all incumbent upon whatever the governor tells us. And I think is right at this time, he says 10 people is the limit. Now, when that'll go away, I don't know. And I don't think anybody else does. We're still waiting on some clarification on the executive order that he came out with this week. Hopefully to have that more clarification on that by the end of the week and maybe have something for the next meeting, if that's true. And now, Max, you said something about John Luke was putting together or facilitating a group to talk about certain things. And I see that John Luke is on. So if you will, we might ask John Luke just to give us all a sense of what's going on with that, John Luke.
Hey, can everybody hear me?
Gotcha.
Just happened to join in time. What kind of the history of what happened there was I noticed that you and the sheriff and the commissioner and y'all were having these local public safety meetings, and I thought that was really great. And I, you know how I am, I just kind of talked off the cuff, and I was talking to the sheriff, and I said, hey, sheriff, I think those meetings y'all are having are a great idea. What if we get kind of a broad spectrum of ideas from all kind of different businesses? We've got doctors involved, churches involved, banks involved, small business, major manufacturers, just to kind of see how this is impacting everybody.
Everybody, yeah.
And so we had our first meeting last Thursday. We had, by my record, 25 people attended via Zoom and kind of school systems as well. And we kind of started talking about what we're experiencing and how maybe we could work together to solve some of these problems locally.
So, John Luke, I'd like to have 26 people on that. If you could send me a link, please.
I sure can. We don't have the next meeting scheduled yet, but we typically, I think, we're tentatively going for tomorrow. So I'll.
And now, how about others that are listening here today? Is there any way that how many people do you want or not want on this thing? Because a lot of people are trying to find all they can.
Well, at this point, and I don't know. We just kind of tried it last week.
Okay.
And well, we're kind of going from there.
Great. Okay. Anything else from anyone?
Yeah, this is Margaret, Steve.
Margaret.
Just to help out to Josh a bit. And this is germ-free, folks. You can go on the First Foundation First Readers and you can donate to Josh online. Germ-free, no cash, no checks, no mail to worry about. Just donate online. It's really
contact-free.
All right, thank you, Margaret. Anyone else now?
John Luke, this is Judy Harvey. Can you send me something also for the bulletin? I'm looking for content. And that sounds like a topic that everybody will be really interested in hearing what's going on.
Okay.
Okay, if you can send it to me by like Sunday, that would be perfect.
What would you need?
Just an article, a synopsis of what y'all are doing and just to make people aware because I'm fascinated by the fact that y'all have this group together. And I think a lot of people would be interested in what's going on and what your outlook is and what your plans are and so forth. So just an information article and an email would be fine or a Word document or something.
Okay. I'll get you something.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Josh, if you will put up our four-way test and everyone unmute, let's say our four-way test today. Of the things we think, say, and do. Is it the truth?
Is it fair to all?
Fair to all concerned. The bill, goodwill, and better friendships.
Better friendships.
And will it be beneficial to all concerned? Thank you so much for everyone. Wonderful meeting, and I look forward to next week. Have a great, safe weekend.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye.